Today, I'm going to talk about a math problem with a fancy name called Maximum Cardinality Bipartite Matching. Let me start by introducing an example. Suppose there are five people, and let's say we have the following jobs. Our goal is to assign jobs to people. We can represent the people and the jobs as points. They're also called vertices or nodes in graph theory. What makes this problem complicated is that not everyone can do every job. For example, Andy can either be a scientist or a farmer, and we can represent his options as edges. Bonnie wants to either be a chef or a scientist. And so on. We have a bunch of people with very diverse skills. Now, we'll try to match jobs to people. This is one possible assignment. Here, Andy is a scientist, Bonnie is a chef, Daisy is a mechanic, and Ed is a banker. But there are lots of other possible matchings, like this one. This, however, is not a matching. This is because both Daisy and Ed are bankers. In math terms, we don't want a vertex to belong to multiple edges in a matching. Finally, this is also a matching, but it's really bad because only Bonnie has a job. Everyone else is unemployed. Our goal, then, is not just to find any matching, because that's very easy, but to find a matching with the largest size. Now, let's revisit the name of our problem. Maximum cardinality just means largest size. In our context, it means give as many people jobs as possible. Bipartite is a special type of graph, which makes finding the largest matching much easier. In a bipartite graph, the vertices can be divided into two sets, where there are no internal edges in each set. So our example here is a bipartite graph. Let's go back to the bad matching we had before, where only Bonnie had a job. This matching is obviously bad, because we could have easily given other people jobs, like we could have made Daisy a farmer. There are other edges we can add to our matching, like make Kathy a scientist and Ed a mechanic. But if we do this, Andy's only options are scientist or farmer. However, they're already assigned to Kathy and Daisy, so Andy can't be matched. Let's go back and see if we could have avoided this and given everyone a job. First, we gave Bonnie and Daisy jobs. From here, if we look at the remaining nodes and edges that can still be matched, it's clear what the problem is. Andy and Kathy are fighting over the same job, but in this cruel world we live in, one of them will be unemployed. In general, if you have n people and fewer than n jobs, at least one person will be unmatched. In mathematics, this observation is called the pigeonhole principle. It seems quite obvious, but it shows up a lot. We can also write this condition mathematically. Let W be a set of people. We can define the neighbors of W to be all of the jobs the people in W have as options. For example, here W is 0 and 4, so that's Andy and Ed, and the neighborhood of W is 5, 7, 8, and 9. Here's another example. W is 1 and 2, and the neighborhood of W is 6 and 7. So we can rewrite our observation as, if there's a set of people W where it's larger than its neighborhood, then not everyone can get a job. What's surprising is that the converse of this statement is also true. For each subset W of people, if the neighborhood of W is at least as large as W, then there is a matching where everyone has a job. These two statements combined is called Hall's theorem, which is a classic theorem in graph theory. This second statement helps us answer whether it's even possible to give everyone a job. It requires us to check each subset of people and compare it with its neighborhood. We can do this for our instance because we're working with a small graph, but generally, even for slightly larger graphs, it won't be possible to check all of the subsets. Fortunately for us, the second condition does hold in our case, so there is a matching that gives everyone a job. But Hall's theorem doesn't tell us exactly how we can find this matching. Let's go back to our example before and see what we could have done differently. Right now, Andy has no job, but there's also no banker. Is there some way to switch some assignments around so that Andy gets a job? How about we match someone else to banker, like Daisy? Then, if we do that, she can no longer be a farmer, so that edge gets unmatched. So then we can match Andy to farmer. Wait, so now everyone has a job. By making some clever swaps, we can increase the size of our matching. This was the original matching. What happened is that the edges along this path swapped from not being in the matching to being in the matching, and vice versa. What's special about this path is two things. The first and last vertices are unmatched. And along the path, the edges alternate between not being in the matching and being in the matching. This is called an augmenting path. Here's another example of an augmenting path, which is a bit longer. The path alternates between being in and out of the matching. Again, we can swap along this path, so Ed is matched to banker and unmatched to mechanic. Daisy is then matched to mechanic and unmatched to farmer. Then we can match Andy to farmer. So this gives a new idea. What if we have an algorithm that just does these two things? First, find an augmenting path and swap edges along the path to get a larger matching. Otherwise, if we don't find an augmenting path, we stop the algorithm. We can test it in our current example. Augmenting paths essentially lets you fix poor assignments that we made before. This algorithm does end up matching everyone in our case, so Andy finally has a job and can feed himself, especially as a farmer. Let's test this on a larger graph. The main question is, does this algorithm always terminate in a maximum matching? Or in other words, if we can't find an augmenting path, do we have the largest matching, or is it possible that there's a larger matching that can't be found by just finding augmenting paths? There's a famous theorem in graph theory that answers this, and it's called Berge's theorem. It states, given a graph G and a matching M, if there are no augmenting paths, then M is, in fact, a maximum matching. And if M is a maximum matching, then there are no augmenting paths. So this theorem is saying finding augmenting paths is all we need to do. Our algorithm here of just finding an augmenting path will always terminate in a maximum matching. Also, for this theorem, G does not have to be bipartite. This applies for all graphs. Lots of matching algorithms tend to just be, how do we find an augmenting path most efficiently? Now, let's go into the technicalities of how to find an augmenting path. Consider this graph again, and this matching. This is not a maximum matching, because vertices 2 and 8 are unmatched, and there is a matching that matches everyone. So, our goal is to find an augmenting path from 2 to 8. Let's follow our intuition, and try to build an augmenting path from scratch. We start at vertex 2, since it's unmatched. All of the possible first edges in our augmenting path are the unmatched edges from vertex 2. There are two possible edges where either 6 or 7 is the next node. We finished exploring vertex 2, so we mark it as done and move on to one of its neighbors. Suppose 6 is the next vertex in the augmenting path. Since the second edge in an augmenting path has to be in the matching, it has to contain the edge 1-6. Let's move to vertex 7. Here, the first edge in the augmenting path we're building is 2-7. So, the second edge has to be a matched edge. Hence, 0 needs to be the next vertex. Let's move to vertex 1. We need to choose an unmatched edge. 1-7 is an unmatched edge. However, we've already explored 7. So this is a dead end. Let's move to vertex 0. Again, we need to choose an unmatched edge, because this is the third edge in our augmenting path. This time, we do have an edge. In fact, this is the vertex we're looking for. Therefore, the augmenting path is 2, 7, 0, 8. What I showed you is a graph traversal algorithm called breadth first search. However, you don't need to use breadth first search. You could use another traversal algorithm like depth first search, and it would also work. Let's summarize the full algorithm and talk about runtime. In each iteration, we try to find an augmenting path using breadth-first search. If there is an augmenting path, we swap assignments to get a larger matching. Otherwise, the algorithm ends. Now, running breadth-first search might require examining all the edges. The worst-case runtime is O of E. If you're not familiar with this notation, it means in the worst case, the runtime is proportional to the number of edges. We might have to run this for all the vertices in one side of the bipartite graph, So the total worst-case runtime is roughly the number of vertices times the number of edges. Finally, there is an improvement on this algorithm where we do one breadth-first search and we can find multiple augmenting paths. This improvement is called the Hopcroft-Karp algorithm, and it has a runtime of square root of v times e. Hope you found this useful. Next time, we'll talk about an algorithm for finding matchings on bipartite graphs with edge weights. See you then.